matter how noble or saintly the hero, all have inner demons they either embrace or reject. Inversely, benevolence can be found in the depths of darkness. This is true of both the Holy Virgin, Jeanne d'Arc, and the King of Knights, Artoria Pendragon. Jeanne d'Arc is a pure and humble country girl, born in Domremy, France. She intends to live her life like the other villagers, until she hears what she believes to be God's grief and lamentation. Jeanne takes this as a call to arms, and so she joins the French military during the Hundred Years' War. Despite adversity, she proves herself to be a brilliant leader, her banner a symbol of divine righteousness. Her most loyal officer, Gilles de Rais, truly believes in Jeanne's calling, impressed further by her faith in the absence of formal schooling and churchly upbringing. Thus, he fights valiantly alongside her as a mentor and passionate ally. Together, Jeanne's forces manage to reclaim and liberate Orleans during the war. Yet, her triumph does not last. Jeanne is captured by her enemy and put on trial under the English Church, who seek to denounce her connection to God as traitorous blasphemy. She is damned, regardless of her actions, and sentenced to being burned at the stake. Even when paraded through town, struck with stones thrown from angry and irate citizens, she merely wishes to hold close a cross and accept her fate without regret or disdain from the God she believes is still sorrowful. She calmly allows her body to burn to ash, forgiving those who wronged her, and she is later made a saint for her martyrdom. Following this, however, there is one who cannot accept this fate. Gilles de Rais, who has first-hand experience of Jeanne's sincerity, kindness, and conviction, cannot forgive the Church, the French nobility who allowed her to die, and most of all, the very God she gave her life for. What God would so cruelly punish their most devout? Gilles begins to doubt God's benevolence and existence, seeking to confirm his suspicion by committing atrocities. He delves into dark magecraft, torturing children in an attempt to force God's hand. But in the end, he is convicted by his people, not out of moral obligation, but for their selfish coveting of his wealth and estate. When Gilles is hanged for his crimes, he dies believing his God does not exist. This sows seeds of chaos, as the demon god amalgamation Getia invokes its incineration of humanity, dispatching holy grails to various key points in history to produce singularities. One such grail is placed within Orleans during the Hundred Years' War, and various heroic spirits are summoned along with it. Among them is Gilles de Rais, in the height of his madness. In desperation, he uses the grail to summon forth an imaginary Jeanne, a version of his beloved saint who can accompany him in his demonic campaign. This is Jeanne d'Arc Altar, a version of Jeanne who succumbs to vengeful hatred toward those who had her burned. As an Avenger-class servant, she wields scalding flames of hatred to obliterate key members of the Church. These flames comprise her noble phantasm, La Grandement du Haine, Roar, O Rage of Mine, a twisted version of Luminosit Eternelle that halts her foes and swells to burn them. Her fire is kindled from her grudges and surrounding mana, hot enough to burn her opponent's injustice, corruption, and self-righteousness, such that even the marrow of their bones turns to ash. Harnessing the grail further, she and Gilles conjure a number of servants, inflicting madness enhancement upon them to force subjugation. Lastly, she calls forth the horrific dragon Fafnir and an army of wyverns to take France and exact her revenge. While Gilles basks in the glory of his fallen saint, their conquest is brought to a halt by the arrival of Caldea's master, Ritsuka Fujimaru, who is accompanied by Jeanne's pure form and Gilles' more faithful version. Regardless, the fallen caster and avenger fight a losing battle, with Jeanne Altar being defeated and Gilles following not long after. Ritsuka indeed resolves the singularity, but Gilles' wish on the grail has forever inscribed the fictitious Jeanne Altar into the throne of heroes to return as a heroic spirit. On the other hand, there is Artoria Pendragon, the king who protects Britain from Saxon invasion after drawing Caliburn from its stone. From her early childhood, Artoria is raised to be an ideal king who sacrifices herself for her kingdom. One might say she is similar to Jeanne in that regard. She amasses loyal knights who join her at the Round Table in Camelot, where they continue war campaigns against invasion. One of these invaders comes in the form of a man, Torak Torriath, who murders, steals, and consumes without remorse. He is punished by being transformed into a giant demon boar, with a razor, scissors, and comb strewn about within his hair. The beast's rampaging greed does not subsist after the transformation. Rather, it spurns him onward towards Britain, where he and his seven piglets ravage and devour the land. Artoria marks the demon boar as a target, hoping to retrieve his razor, scissors, and comb, in addition to protecting her country. Thus, she takes to the swine hunt, accompanied by her favorite hunting dog, Caval. Together, they manage to drive the demon boar out of Britain. While King Arthur is known for vanquishing various threats on the battlefield, her people begin to spread the sentiment that she is not human, that she does not understand human feelings. Rather, she is so earnestly dedicated to creating order for her kingdom that she refuses to bask in her own happiness, proving to be a poor role model for her people. This takes shape in her military tactics, using scorched earth policies to ruin her enemy's ability to reclaim valuable land. Because she herself is ready and willing to dive into combat, she drags her troops into combat as well, despite their lack of morale. Of course, this is merely an interpretation of her rule. Artoria truly loves her people, smiling only for their sake. Thus, in the wake of suspicion, her saint-like devotion to kingship alienates the very people she fights to protect. This alienation only grows thicker when Artoria campaigns in Rome, and Lord Agravain discovers that Sir Lancelot and Guinevere are having an affair. The fallout enables Mordred to rally Artoria's troops against her, erupting in the Battle of Camlann, spelling the end for both of them. While in life Artoria is a king of high moral standing, under certain circumstances, she will be willing to commit evil atrocities if it means maintaining order. Part of her is willing to accept that to become a hero, she must earn the scorn of others. Thus, should her spirit origin invert, Artoria Pendragon can exist as the heroic spirit Artoria Alter. This potential is even embedded within the Holy Sword Excalibur itself, which can become tainted in darkness. This jet-black blade, known as Excalibur Morgan, Sword of Promised Victory, takes on the inversion of Vivian, Lady of the Lake, the evil within Artoria's older sister, Morgan Le Fay. She can unleash its divine light, just as she would in its default form, but in this dark form she utilizes a technique called Vortigern, Hammer of the Vile King, to repeatedly slash the blade upwards. Artoria Alter's form also has an encounter with Ritsuka Fujimaru during the Singularity in Fuyuki City. The Dark Servant is given the Grail by conspirator Lev Liner and tasked with maintaining the Singularity, which she does by restarting the Holy Grail War that took place in Fuyuki years prior. Artoria Alter confronts Ritsuka's servant, Mashu Kirialite, in the caverns of Mount Enzo. She admires Mashu's determination, but fails to realize the true nature of her noble phantasm, Lord Camelot. Thus, Artoria Alter is felled, just like Jeanne to follow. Essentially, these two heroes can emerge in forms that embrace evil, but even then, given the context, they can also be forces of benevolence. Both Alter servants join the battle to save humanity from incineration, supporting Ritsuka Fujimaru quite dependably. During Christmas, Artoria is summoned as a rider-class servant, choosing to embody Santa Claus and spread holiday joy by delivering useless craft essences. The following year, that task falls upon Jeanne Alter, who is reverted to a child's body thanks to the Potion of Youth contained within Gilgamesh's Gate of Babylon. For the holiday, Ritsuka reprises their role as a reindeer to essentially babysit the more naive and harmless Santa Alter Lily. While ridiculous, these moments help create an environment for the two Alters to thrive without resorting to evil. This becomes a blessing when, following the defeat of Getia and the demon god Pillars, a new singularity emerges in an isolated version of Shinjuku in 1999. Feeling the matter urgent, Mashu and Da Vinci ray-shift Ritsuka to the singularity to investigate. Ritsuka quickly encounters a mysterious archer who explains the desolate state of the city, its territories sectioned off by members of the Phantom League of Fiends. Thanks to the singularity being separate from human history, the Counterforce does not intervene in danger, strangely allowing the presence of phantoms, urban myths and stories that lack the fame to form spirit graphs, to manifest and even combine with each other. Here, the phantoms dominate the Shinjuku underworld, ultimately planning to destroy it. When Ritsuka reaches the highway, they are hunted by the Hessian Lobo, a voracious wolf rode by the Headless Horseman. Fortunately, they are saved by none other than Artoria Alter, who blazes through the city on her motorcycle, the Motored Kuriase, which channels her mana to enhance the performance of her Yamaha V-Max. She takes Ritsuka to safety in her roost, the basement of an abandoned burger joint. Artoria, in her alter form, has taken quite a liking to junk food, much like her homunculus child, Mordred. To guard the roost, Artoria has employed the help of a snow-white dog she dubs Sir Caval II. While she denies being Caval's owner, the two nonetheless share a close bond, and Artoria considers Caval more esteemed than Ritsuka. The Chaldean party's peace is disturbed, with the inclusion of Jean Alter, who also joins the young master. Artoria and Jean simply cannot get along with each other, with Jean referring to Artoria as the Ice Bitch Queen, and Artoria calling Jean a mad dog. Regardless, they are able to set their instinctive hostility aside to help resolve the singularity. The group is joined by Sherlock Holmes, and the Shinjuku Archer is discovered to be James Moriarty. Together, they target the Phantom Assassin, Yan Qing, by infiltrating a lavish party of his. Artoria and Jean Alter don elegantly sexy dresses, while Ritsuka is forced to disguise as the opposite sex. Regardless, Artoria Alter draws Ritsuka in close for a ball dance. Jean Alter wants a piece of the action, but their fun is interrupted by Yan Qing. The building explodes, and their battle resumes in the street. With Yan Qing's defeat, the group is once again attacked by Hessian Lobo. Unprepared, they agree that one of them must buy the other's time to escape. Jean Alter stays behind and incurs a seemingly fatal bite from the wolf, and fears she will perish. With knowledge that Lobo is an Avenger, Jean Alter wishes to put the beast out of its misery, knowing that the pursuit of vengeance can devour one's sanity. Unfortunately, she is left with no choice but to escape through a manhole and go into hiding with the aid of Edmond Dantes. Back at the roost, Ritsuka, Moriarty, Sherlock, and Artoria strategize how to trap the rampaging wolf and decide to use Caval II as bait. Lobo hates the hunters who killed his mate, but is so consumed with rage that he can no longer recognize her. Thus, Caval, despite being a mere dog, may very well distract Lobo enough to restrain him. Artoria is reluctant to agree, until Caval apparently volunteers for the position, at least according to Foe and Moriarty. Sure enough, Caval's image from a distance is enough to slow Lobo into falling for a trap. The wolf is wounded and dies shortly after amputating itself to escape. Ultimately, Ritsuka and her servants storm Shinjuku's tallest structure, a massive gun barrel being used to summon and fire a meteor. At the top, they discover that the Singularity's purpose was to lure in and kill Ritsuka, fueled by vengeance from the demon god Baal, who had escaped from Solomon's Temple of Time. The incoming meteorite will crush the master, but help arrives in the nick of time, thanks in part to Jean Alter returning for the final battle. The meteor, at this point shattered into pieces, still plummets toward Shinjuku. Artoria Alter, brandishing the true name of her black sword, decimates the remaining debris. Ritsuka reclaims the Grail, causing the summoned servants to disappear. Without time to spare, Jean Alter takes this last moment to lovingly dance with Ritsuka. On the other side of town, Artoria Alter returns to bid farewell to Caval II, offering the dog freedom to roam the city. As Shinjuku eventually corrects itself, Caval howls into the night sky, but this is certainly not the end of Chaldea's adventures. In the midst of summer, Jeanne d'Arc Alter is summoned as a berserker, clad in a well-fit bikini. In this form, she can unleash a different noble phantasm, Verkamord Fuyadache, incinerated Heaven's Law, Dragon of Extermination, to unleash dragon-like energy to devour and slice her enemies. Artoria Alter also arms herself, especially for the beach, donning a glorious swimsuit as a maid who wields a pistol named Sakase. With both her Excalibur mop and her firearm, she performs Sakase Morgan, Sword of Tenacious Burning Victory, to conjure a rifle and gun down her foes while atop her motorcycle. In the end, while the two servants embrace evil, they are not wholly consumed by it, allowing them to stay by Ritsuka's side during both peaceful and trying times. Thanks for watching! If you enjoy this channel, help me beat the algorithm by liking, commenting, and sharing the video, subscribing to Otaku Daikun, and most of all, smashing that notification bell as if it were your waifu. That way, you'll never miss out on all of my anime content, lore videos, live streams, and Holy Waifu Wars polls. My vids are struggling to get featured, so that bell is absolutely critical. If you want to support me directly, check out my Patreon, or consider donating via Super Chat. And as always, celebrate your fandom!